Honors, and may it please the court, my name is Chris Rethery. I represent the appellant, Cecilia Fraher, who is an inmate within the California Department of Corrections. This case involves Ms. Fraher's claims under Section 1983 for improper medical care in violation of the Eighth Amendment. Ms. Fraher is classified as a chronic care patient within the Department of Corrections, meaning that she's totally disabled and is a high risk and has serious medical needs as a result of a heart valve transplant that she had previously. With her condition, she's extremely vulnerable to infections and other type of sicknesses that can cause that heart valve to deteriorate. What is at issue in this case is over the course of a 2.5 month period, she started feeling very sick, complaining of symptoms that are symptomatic of some type of infection and possibly endocarditis, which is an infection in the heart, which could cause her prosthetic valve to deteriorate. And so during the course of this 2.5 month period, she sought treatment on several different occasions where she was complaining of flu-like symptoms, a cough that would not go away, night sweats, shortness of breath, chest pain. All of these complaints are pretty much textbook symptomatic of some type of infection and possibly endocarditis.
But also textbook flu and other things.
Correct, Your Honor. And the problem here, I guess, is that with a patient like Ms. Fraher, who has this history, when these symptoms, which for other people may be just typical flu, when those are presented with someone in her condition, they could be indicative of something more serious. And so that's at the heart of this case, is that more should have been done to evaluate her, to order testing, to refer her for the certain types of testing that could have prevented the ultimate congestive heart failure that she suffered from in this case and almost died from.
How do we know more should have been done? And what's the evidence that supports that proposition?
That's an excellent question, Your Honor. In the record, of course, Ms. Fraher, she represented herself in the district court. She, as an inmate, she's limited in the resources that she has, what type of evidence that she's able to obtain to present. But what she did present in opposition to the motion for summary judgment, as well as once the magistrate made its recommendation, she also opposed that to the district court, where she presented a lot of evidence from respected medical journals which describe what are problematic for a person in her condition, as well as what's the appropriate treatment and how things should be done. Like, for instance, in this case, there were several occasions where she presented with flu-like symptoms. She was determined to have an elevated temperature, and on each of these occasions, what should have been done, according to the evidence that she presented, which could, I think, does have some evidentiary value in the sense that they're learned treatises, they could have been used in cross-examination against the other doctors, although she didn't have a medical professional herself to testify to this. But, for instance, some of the things that could have been done, if they ordered antibiotics on a couple of occasions, according to these journals, in a patient like Ms. Fraher, what you should first do is order a blood test to determine whether infection is present.
Let me just stop for a moment. I mean, one of the difficulties with these Eighth Amendment cases is that ordinary medical malpractice, even if the care fell below the standard of care and the prison put evidence in the record that it didn't fall below the standard of care, but even if it does fall below the standard of care, how do we differentiate between that and what's necessary for a constitutional violation, which requires deliberate indifference?
Right.
So it's not enough just to show it fell below the standard of care, which is not even clear here it did. It has to go up to deliberate indifference. So how do we get there?
And that's exactly right, Your Honor. For a constitutional violation, it requires more than mere negligence or failure of standard of care. For inmates, and it, their there's a somewhat relaxed standard, according to some precedent, where it requires recklessness. But what deliberate indifference has been defined as is that you knew or should have known of a serious medical needs and risk of harm, and despite that knowledge, chose not to do anything about it. And in this case, what we have is 10 days before she was ultimately admitted to the hospital with congenitive heart failure, the doctor had in his order form written stat echo, meaning an echocardiogram on an urgent basis. But then he crossed it out and referred, and instead did a routine referral to her cardiologist. We contend that that evidence alone in this case demonstrates that he subjectively had the knowledge that she needed this additional treatment or that this
doesn't does suggest just as much he thought about it, gave consideration, wasn't indifferent to it, and decided, no, that's not the appropriate course for this patient.
And that could be the case, Your Honor. But I think for summary judgment purposes, for the court to make that determination and weigh the evidence like that, that the court did exactly the opposite of what it should have done, which was draw every fair inference in her favor and accept her facts as true. But what I believe...
What would you point at? I mean, we have a declaration from Dr. Burnett, who seems well-credentialed, offered up by defendant. Okay, we're in summary judgment. Even accepting the fact that your client's resources are limited, what can you point to that would create a genuine dispute of fact in response to the declaration on behalf of defendant that says this is not an inappropriate course to pursue?
And what we would point to, and what I believe Ms. Fraher pointed to in her briefings, is Dr. Barnett. He has inherent bias, number one. He is basically in charge of the department who's being alleged to have not provided proper care. He's the boss of the two people who are sued in this case. Within his affidavit, also, he points to an alleged echocardiogram that occurred in early June, but there's no evidence anywhere else in the record of that having occurred. Ms. Fraher doesn't recall having it occurred. Also, if we were to accept what he says is true, that that echocardiogram did occur and all the results came back not problematic, then what we have a month later, complete failure. Now, he tries to attribute between that 1 to 1.5 month period that this is normal wear and tear. But I think that if you accept what he says is true, that it actually signifies the opposite, that it wasn't normal wear and tear over a one-month period to have complete breakdown in the prosthetic heart valve that she has, as well as the fact that he doesn't discuss that the stat echo was ordered at all, which we contend, had that been done, could have prevented the entire heart failure that she had. He also doesn't identify the fact that leading up to that, that proper protocols weren't followed in the sense of not ordering the blood tests before ordering the antibiotics. And in the instance when they did order the antibiotics and a blood test, they did it 2 weeks afterwards, essentially rendering it completely meaningless, since the antibiotics had killed any infection that would have been detected in that, as well as the fact that while the defendants and the appellees dispute this, Ms. Fraher contends that on several occasions when she went to treat with R.N. Lee as well as Dr. Mitchell, that they, to her, articulated that they believed her problems were just menopausal. But
no, the doctor never said that.
Well, she contends that he does. It's not in his medical records, but she says that there were three occasions. There were two times with Nurse Lee. I see I'm running out of time pretty quickly.
You've got to reserve your time for a bottle. That's fine.
But I will. Let me just finish the answer here. So R.N. Lee, two times, she says that he attributed everything to menopausal, and then on the other time when they run a urine culture and it came back with blood in her urine, which is also extremely problematic. doctor left, went and referred to the nurse, came back in and asked the nurse to say, tell her what you told me. And he said, don't worry about it. It's probably just menopause. And I'd like to reserve my last 2 seconds. Thank you.
We'll still give you a minute for rebuttal.
Thank you.
We'll hear from defendants.
Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the Court, Kevin Voth, Deputy Attorney General for Defendants Dr. Mitchell and Nurse Lee. May Your Honors, deliberate indifference is a high legal standard and is not met in the medical care context by simply showing a difference of opinion regarding a particular diagnosis and treatment. Rather, what Ms. Fraher must demonstrate is that the treatment she received was medically unacceptable under the circumstances and it was chosen with a conscious disregard for the risk of harm. And here she has failed to rebut defendants' evidence, first that their treatment decisions were medically proper, but also she's presented no evidence to rebut the expert testimony that her valve failure, her 11-year-old prosthetic valve failure, was caused by structural deterioration due to its age and was not preventable by Dr. Mitchell or Nurse Lee. Now, although it's unfortunate that Ms. Fraher had to be hospitalized and have surgery for the valve failure, that fact is not evidence that the defendants were deliberately indifferent to her condition, and neither are her lay opinions second-guessing their specific treatment decisions.
It's true that there could be, and I think Dr. Burnett's declaration talks about it, deterioration in the heart valve, but would the deterioration have manifested itself with the symptoms she presented? Is there any evidence that that would be the case?
Well, it's not clear how the heart valve failure would have manifested, but Dr. Mitchell...
I didn't glean anything from Dr. Burnett's declaration that suggests that the symptoms she showed could have derived from the deterioration. I read his declaration to say, look, valves deteriorate, so she was going to have to go through this anyway. Sort of a no harm because it was going to happen no matter what, which is not quite the same as saying what she showed up with could be explained by deterioration. I didn't see things that supported that proposition, which goes back to the question of whether Dr. Mitchell or Nurse Lee should have picked up on the symptoms and offered a different diagnosis.
Well, with what Dr. Barnett and Dr. Mitchell both testified about was that Dr. Mitchell had performed other diagnostic exams that were determinative or provided objective findings regarding the degree of heart failure. In each instance, he checked her for peripheral edema, which is ankle swelling, an indication that whether or not she was suffering from congestive heart failure. He also ordered a chest x-ray in July that can also demonstrate if there's fluid in the lungs, another indicator of whether or not there's congestive heart failure. Furthermore, he had ordered that she have this echocardiogram done in June, and there's no dispute that whether or not the echocardiogram occurred. And Dr. Barnett specifically testified about the records that he reviewed and the results and the findings that they showed, which was that her echocardiogram in June of 2009 was consistent with her cardiac history and prior exam results. So, although specifically with regard to the valve failure and what sort of symptoms might present here, the undisputed facts demonstrate that what Ms. Fraher's theory of the case, which is that she should have been treated for endocarditis, that is not supported by the objective findings and the defendant's medical evidence. And her theory is based on her belief that if they had taken steps to treat her for endocarditis, that they could have caught the valve failure problem in advance, but that's not supported by the symptoms that she actually reported. And Dr. Barnett specifically testified that her bioprosthetic valve was of a type that was known to have problems with structural deterioration over time. They were likely to fail between 10 and 15 years, and her valve, in fact, was already 11 years old.
Well, what do we do about the fact that, I guess it was one of the Dr. Mitchell had ordered an echocardiogram
problems with that assertion. And first is that Ms. Fraher didn't actually raise this issue before the district court. She didn't point out this purported factual issue, and so it was waived. But also, Dr. Mitchell specifically testified that his treatment decisions were based on his clinical judgment and the symptoms that she reported with. The stat echo, and is crossing out, all that shows is that he had made a decision, a determination, to not proceed with an echocardiogram diagnostic and instead to treat her with other diagnostic exams instead. He specifically ordered that she have a chest x-ray. He ordered additional antibiotic treatment for her and referred her for a follow-up with her cardiologist. And furthermore, he was aware that she had had an echocardiogram just a few weeks beforehand in June of 2009. And so the fact that he had crossed out stat echo is reasonable given the fact that he was aware she had just had an echocardiogram a few weeks earlier. So that fact by itself does not create a material dispute about whether the treatment decisions were medically unacceptable. Now, with respect to Ms. Fraher's allegations regarding Nurse Lee and the statements that were made, Ms. Fraher presented no evidence to demonstrate that Nurse Lee's treatment of the symptoms that she came in with in May were medically unacceptable under the circumstances. And she alleges that Nurse Lee had made this statement attributing her symptoms to menopause, which he denies, but even if he had made this statement, that alone is not evidence that the treatment that he actually provided to Ms. Fraher was medically unacceptable. She presented to him with cough and cold symptoms, coughing, chest congestion, sore throat, and he provided her with cough and cold medicine. And when she returned, complaining of the same flu-like symptoms, then he scheduled her for an appointment with a doctor. And Ms. Fraher notes that she had had these symptoms for some time, but on April 28th, just a few days before she saw Nurse Lee, she made these same complaints about her condition to her cardiologist, Dr. Bomber, about having the chest congestion, the flu-like symptoms, and Dr. Bomber concluded that it was probably a viral syndrome, didn't require emergency care. When she came back to the prison, Dr. Mitchell treated her, evaluated her, as I mentioned, sought objective findings regarding congestive heart failure issues like the presence or absence of peripheral edema, and determined that emergent care was not necessary. Dr. Bomber had said that she needed to have an echocardiogram and a CTA done. Dr. Mitchell ordered those tests. They were performed. And there's no evidence to show that throughout this course of treatment between April 28th and July 17th, when she eventually reported worsening symptoms, difficulty breathing, she exhibited edema in the ankles. At that point, then, she was taken to the hospital and given emergency treatment. Further tests revealed that she was having the problem with the heart valve. And although there was a suspicion of endocarditis at that time, and this is, again, after other diagnostic tests had not revealed any heart valve failure, when she's at the hospital, they suspected endocarditis, but the post-surgical findings, which are undisputed, showed that, in fact, there was no endocarditis.
Now, that was curious to me. So there is no actual finding at the end that she had endocarditis.
That is correct.
It was only a preliminary pre-surgery thought of that.
That's correct. They suspected it based on what they believed was a vegetation on the valve, which is a accumulation of bacteria and blood cells that perhaps it was endocarditis, but when they actually performed the surgery, they found no evidence of infection. And what they found was that.
That's the final report.
That is correct. And what?
Gold report.
Exactly. And so the final conclusion was it was structural deterioration. And if there are no further questions, Your Honor.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So I think you should talk about that first, because that doesn't that end the case? If that's true.
If it is true, but the problem is they haven't made one determination one way or the other. When they did the surgery, they didn't find the infection because she'd already been on antibiotics for 3 weeks. So had she not been on Amvax, it might have been a different story. But because under the circumstances.
Is that in the record? So I'm not a doctor. I don't know if the antibiotics would eliminate signs of endocarditis. Is that in the record? Is there medical evidence in the record to that effect?
I'm not sure, Your Honor. And I don't know definitively whether having taken the antibiotics would completely eliminate all aspects of infection or whether specifically with regard to endocarditis. But my understanding is that once you take antibiotics and then test or don't find infection, it is not indicative or dispositive of the fact that infection didn't exist prior to
taking it. So you're just saying this to me as a lawyer, is that right?
I guess so, Your Honor. Well, my understanding is based on reviewing the case and the evidence. I see that my time's up.
Thank you. Thank both counsel for your helpful arguments. The case just argued is submitted.